Institute Divine Metaphysical Research Incorporated. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity into this present day. This school was established as a result of divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Since that time, we established branch schools in the United States, Canada, and certain other foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we teach by the true, correct, and original names and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in original Hebrew text. The true name of the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has improperly been substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has improperly been substituted by God. The true name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has erroneously been substituted by Jesus Christ. Now, Lord and God are titles and are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lord's many and God's many. But we now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for himself. Now, Jesus is a name, but Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in any good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any letters or characters in their alphabet that has produced the sound by the letter J. Neither was there a J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings to the true, correct, and original names of the Father and his Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit, and in his pure spirit stays incomprehensible and inscrutable. He's the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh on this chart symbolized as a cloud. But Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular scriptive shape and form. We have drawn a cloud around the edges of this chart to show you how everything on this chart abides within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in his pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a superincorporeal being, that is, having a shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifests into a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given among salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we must all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him this tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. These three compartments make up this one tabernacle pattern. Also in this school, we show proof how that everything is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing can escape the pattern. Our 10 primary constitutional objectives and aims of the Institute are as follows. 1, to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. 2, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. 3, to investigate the unexplained spirit law or the so-called laws of nature and the powers latent in man. 4, to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, modern practical, and occult sciences. 5, to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. 6, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensation and ages. 7, to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation and time. 8, to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith, which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. 9, to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among man whereby man can be saved, saving in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And 10, to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in a new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. This morning we'll have a prayer by Dr. Ignacio Ramirez and a scripture reading of Acts the 3rd chapter by Irene Ramirez, and there will be a selection of music in between.
So, bow our hearts and mind. We thank you, Yahshua, for bringing us together this morning to learn more about your purpose, pattern, plan, and your creation, and to have faith in you all the time. All this we ask in your precious old name, Yahshua's side. Let's all say,
through the trees. You can see it in the wings of a bird flying free. You can see it in a flower as it reaches for the sky. Every ocean praises Yahweh in overwhelming size. So let's sing hallelujah.
specifically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised with the late A.B. Trainum, the Research Association Incorporated. And I'll be reading Acts, the third chapter. Now Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour, and a certain man lame from his mother's womb was being carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to take alms of them that enter into the temple, who, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked them alms. And Peter, fastening his eyes upon him and John, said, Look on us. And he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. Then Peter said, Silver and gold have I none, but such I have give I thee. In the name of Yahshua Messiah of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And he took them by the right hand and lifted him up. And immediately his feet and ankles, bones received strength. And he leaping up, stood up and walked and entered with them into the temple. And the leaping and praising Elohim. And all the people saw him walking and praising Elohim. And they knew that he was he which sat for alms at the beautiful gate of the temple. And they were filled with wonder, amazed at that which had happened unto him. And as the lame man which was healed held Peter and John, all the people ran together unto him in the porch that is called Solomon's, greatly wondering. And when Peter saw it, he said unto the people, Ye men of Israel, why marvel ye at this? Or why look ye so earnestly on us, as though your own power or holiness we have made this man walk? The Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob, the Elohim of our fathers, had glory, his son, Yahshua, whom ye delivered up and denied him in the presence of Pilate, when he was determined to let him go. But ye denied the Holy One and the just, and desiring a murderer to be granted unto you, and killed the Prince of Peace, whom Yahweh had raised up from the dead, whereof we are witnesses, and through faith in his name, this man have been made strong, whom ye see and know ye the faith which is by him, has given him this perfect soundness in the presence of you all. And now, brethren, I know that through ignorance ye did it, and did also your rulers. But those things which Elohim before had declared by the mouth of all the prophets, that the Messiah should suffer, he hath so and has so fulfilled. Repent ye therefore and be converted, and your sins may be blotted out to the end that the times of the refreshing shall come from the presence of Yahweh. Unto he shall send Yahshua, the Messiah, who has been previously appointed for you, whom the heavens must retain in the times of restitution of all things, which Yahweh has spoken by the mouth of all the holy prophets since the beginning of ages. And Moses truly said unto the fathers, A prophet shall Yahweh your Elohim raise up unto you of your brethren, like unto me. Him shall ye hear in all things whosoever he shall say unto you. And it shall come to pass that every soul which will not hear the prophet shall be destroyed from among the people. Yea, all the prophets from Samuel and those that followed after, as many have spoken, have likewise foretold of these days. Ye are the children of the prophets and of the covenant which Yahweh made with our fathers, saying unto Abraham, And in thy seed shall be the kindreds, and the earth be blessed. Unto you first Yahweh, having raised up his son, Yahshua, sent him to bless you in turning away every one of you from his iniquities. And I have read Acts, the third chapter. Let's all say, Hallelujah.
Good morning again, class.
Good morning.
I'd like to call our first speaker today. It will be Dr. Kennaway Kleinschmidt.
Hello. Good morning, class. This is a surprise. I haven't been to class for quite a while. I've been listening mainly, but I've been coming at least twice a week. It's funny because I was thinking about giving a little testimony on how I came into this class. And when you come in, you think, oh, well, these are just circumstances that happen. But now, after I've been in class all this time, I realize that I didn't realize that Yahweh was talking to me all the time. And when listened to Olivia Dantzler once, and she said, Yahweh talks to you, and I said, I never hear him. And she said, well, what voice do you think he's talking to you in? And I realized that all my life, every thought I had was given to me by Yahshua. And I've only realized this, I've been in class 20 years, and I only realized this, like, you know, a couple of years ago. And so when I was a Roman Catholic, I went to Mass, I went to all the holy days, I went to everything, and then one day I thought, but Yahshua was talking to me and saying, why do you have to go through a man? You know, that, and I thought, you know, why do I have to go through a man? Why can't I go directly to God? And that's when I quit going to church. And at that time, I was working at the VA in mental health, and so I worked in a ward with the veterans that had a history of assaultive behavior. So we were locked up with them all the time. And so I would do cognitive activities, reality orientation, and they were all very kind to me because I respected them. And so I didn't have any problem with them. And then one day, Will Williams comes onto the ward. Why? So naturally, we're all locked in together with the veterans. And we started talking about these interests we had on these Korean and Japanese docudramas where you learn about the history. And so I borrowed one of his tapes. And then when I returned it, we went and sat outside and were talking. And for some reason, I mean, I never knew the Bible. I knew nothing. I knew generally about Adam and Eve and the stories, but nothing. So I'm talking to him about the wedding in Cana. That's got to be Yahshua talking to me. I never talked the Bible, never, ever. And why the wedding in Cana? Like I knew something. You know, I'm really embarrassed now to think about it. So he says, do you know the true name? And I said, yeah, it's Yahweh. And I said, but he knows who I mean. It doesn't really matter. He said, it does matter. So he says, okay, then I will call you Jenny. Why Jenny? You know, this was Yahshua again. Jenny worked for my brother as one of his assistants. And when she broke up with her boyfriend, she shot him, killed him, ended up in jail. So that really got my attention. Why did he pick the name Jenny? Now that, you know, you could have said Sally or something. And so again, I realized that was Yahshua talking. So he gave me this pink pamphlet, the one about John and Moses, and I read it, and I understood nothing. It didn't make any sense at all to me. So he gave me some things that I read, and a lot of it didn't make any sense. But I got a copy of the textbooks, and no, this was later on. So then he showed me a copy of the textbook, and what got my attention was the fact that everything had three except Moses. it only had two abbreviations. And so when I read about it, it started to make a little sense. And he says, do you want to come to class with me? And I thought, well, don't I have to take some kind of class before, like when you take Psych 1, Psych 2 or something? Don't I have to have some kind of introduction to it? I said, no. So I came to class. And what did they talk about? This, about Moses. I knew the name Moses. I didn't really know anything else. And then they went through the names, and that made sense to me, because when you learn about the names, they all have meaning. When you say Jesus, his name is not Jesus Sr.
That's right.
And there is no J in Hebrew. You know, and it really made sense to me. I thought Catholicism, that people did what was right, and it made sense to me. I would go to confession, and then the priest that I talked to, he was also a skier, so we had a lot in common. But it seemed to make sense to me at the time. But as I came to class, I realized all the things that happened, like Adam and Eve. People say, oh, I wouldn't have done that. But he had to do it. He was following the rule he was given to disobey for a reason. Now, if he had not disobeyed, and if he hadn't left the garden, we wouldn't be here, because angels don't propagate. So as gradually I learned everything Yahweh told me, that I didn't just meet Will accidentally, that Yahshua introduced him to me, and he invited me. I didn't just come to class because he said so. Yahshua put it to invite me to come. So they would come in here and go over Moses, right? So I said, okay. And I didn't understand a whole lot, but I understood enough to know that they were proving what they were saying. So the second time I came, there was Moses again. And I was told we could ask questions, so as people know, I ask a lot of questions, and they go, oh, no, now what? I said, well, is that all you talk about, Moses? Yeah. And, I mean, I think about it now, and it's, you know, really, I learned a lot. I used to think, as Todd said, I used to think I was pretty smart until I came to this class, and I learned that I knew nothing. Anything I know, I can speak a little lot of, I learn languages pretty easily, but it's not I. That's the gift that Yahshua gave to me. He gives each of us different gifts, okay? So then I come again, and I learn about Moses. And as I studied the textbook, I realized that it was really important. Everything that we learn and everything that Moses taught us is really important. And as we went through class, I would ask a lot of questions, which I know now, if you wait, Yahshua knows what you have to know. So I pointed out that at that time, what was it, that
resurrection
was spelled wrong. It had two, you know. Yeah, so I said, do you know that it's spelled wrong? Well, they did correct it. But then when I think about it now, if I had just been patient, Yahshua knows what I want to know.
Yes.
And so usually, I don't ask as many questions now, but I still do periodically, and it's like, oh no, now what does she want to know? Mm-hmm. But I realized too that sometimes the questions I ask, other people want to know too.
Right.
And so it just clarifies things. And I know some of the things I ask is because I don't study enough, and I know that. And lately I've been asking, you would say, ask what you need. I need to learn to study more, like maybe set a day or something to read more. So I realized all this time that Yahshua has been talking to me for everything and helping me to learn things. And when I go to some of these conventions or conferences, it's like a family reunion. You meet these people, and they're just like family. They are family. But you feel very relaxed. You could talk about anything. And we would go to some of these conventions, and then afterwards we would sit around and talk for all hours. And you never learn, you never get fed up with what you have to say. There's always something to say. There's always something to learn. And one of my, John Quates, says somebody asked him, when do you graduate? You know? We never graduate. We learn forever. You can be reading something that you've read many times, and all of a sudden, one word will pop out that you could swear was not there. And Yahshua reveals things to you as you're ready. And so it's just been amazing. And then fortunately, I was invited to this class. And Joe was telling us, when I'd get up, he'd say, well, say what you want, but prove it. And that's the trouble, that in a lot of these classes now, they don't prove it. They say things, and they don't prove anything. It's almost like our government today. They say things without proof, you know. So I'm very grateful that I was invited to this class. I've learned a lot, and I'm still learning. From every speaker has something to say. Somebody may go through Adam and Eve, but you get something different from each person. And I was told that this was changed by life, and I didn't believe it at the time, but it has very much changed my life. And to all of you, it's almost like you're part of my family. I mean, you are part of my family. Yeah, and I love all of you. And you learn something from everyone, no matter what. So I just thank Yahshua for having me coming to this class and learning and keeping me here. Praise Yahshua.
Our next speaker will be Dr. Valencia Dantzler.
Okay. Good morning.
Good morning.
Praise Yahshua. I am so happy to be here. Hello to everyone watching online. I made it to California, and it's been a long journey. I haven't been in this class since 2017 when we had our June 6th conference. I did come to California last year. I was not able to get out here because it's a long way from Los Angeles. As you can see, I'm wearing my Yahshua mask because I'm promoting the gospel. And I do have some. I'm going to take this down. I just wanted to make sure that people saw it because it's just been controversy with these masks. But anyway, this class means a lot to me, this particular class in Ontario. It means everything to me. And I don't want to stand here and say that some of you may not be grateful or may be grateful. I don't know what you feel, but I just want you to know from a person that doesn't live here, because I live in Chicago. Actually, I don't live in Chicago. I live in a small suburb of Chicago called Flossmoor, which is about 45 minutes south of Chicago, and I'm grateful to be in that little suburb because we don't have the violence and the crime that goes on in the city of Chicago. I'm sure you've heard about the things that we go through. And it's not as bad as people are making it out to be, but it does have its moments. But you guys are in such a beautiful class. No one teaches what you all teach here. And I thank Yahshua for this man, Dr. Will Williams, who is my brother. What Yahshua has given him to stand before you, I told him, I said, you need to be teaching at Harvard. Because to go through that 40-plate chart the way that Yahshua has given him the gift to do it is, there are no words to describe what comes out of it. And the last time I was here, and I have to say this because I'm about truth and I'm about keeping it real. The last time I was here was June 6, 2017. And we had the most beautiful spiritual health and wellness conference. And I passed out packets from the one we just did online. What happened was, just to give you a background, I am a student of Dr. Lee Warren, who was in the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research several years ago, and he broke off because of controversies and problems with headquarters and started PLIM, which is Power, Latent, and Man. And he started doing something every year called a survival conference, where he would give you information on investing in gold and silver, health and wellness, how to reverse your health conditions, things of that nature. So he got a little older and decided he didn't want to do it anymore. And so I said, well, Dr. Warren, I'll take over. I said, because this is very important that we continue to save lives. And that's what I'm all about. Yahshua is my husband, that's my man, my friend, and my everything. And all I want to do is help save lives with whatever he has given me and always give the credit back to him. Now, since I have been here over the last 3 years, Yahshua broke my heart because he took some people out of this class. He took Reggie. That really hurt me. I was very hurt. And when Joe died, I was devastated. And I was hurt because I came here and gave you all so much information through Yahshua on how to reverse whatever your problem is and save your life. Can you get Dr. Kinley's words of wisdom for me? Did you get it? Did you find it? Okay. This school was started by a vision that the founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, had. Now, there's some controversy about it. They say it was 1930, 1931. Those are semantics. The bottom line is the man had a divine vision from the Creator. Now, prior to him having this vision, he had been seeking for answers. He was looking for God. Okay? He just didn't all of a sudden have a vision out of nowhere. He had been pondering on his mind. He'd been thinking, like, you know, what is this and what am I doing and how is the universe working? What is God? And he had questions. So Yahweh set him down and got right in him and showed him this information. Do you have it? Words of wisdom? Because it's
tonight on
It's yes, it is.
It is. It's in the introduction.
Because I want that read, because it's very important.
Words of wisdom. Did it ever occur to you that we remain ignorant of attested truth and scientifically proven facts, most particularly because we fail to make a personal, detailed investigation of important matters?
Stop, because we fail to make a personal, detailed investigation. This is Dr. Kinley speaking. And this actually wasn't a lecture. It was just a little paragraph that he wrote. Go on.
This failure to investigate positively retards the progress of our understanding.
This failure to investigate will retard you. Go on.
Retards the progress of our understanding and knowledge in every vocation and phase of life.
In every vocation and phase of life. Go on.
Both physical and spiritual.
Physical and spiritual. Go on.
That's all right. Sometimes stopping and thinking for a moment over the essential things of life.
Stop and think for a moment over the essential things of life. Aren't we living at a time where they keep saying, what's essential? You're an essential worker. You essential worker. Everything is about essentials now. Go on.
Eliminates many regretted years of poverty.
Eliminates many years of regret. Go on.
Of poverty.
Poverty.
Sickness.
Sickness.
Humiliation.
Humiliation.
Embarrassment.
Embarrassment.
And sometimes death and destruction.
And sometimes death and destruction. Which means what he's saying there is you could prevent and avoid that. But if you don't do a detailed investigation, go on and finish.
Therefore, we should learn to pause and try to think intelligently before we finally conclude affirmatively or negatively. We should do this before an ultimatum or final decision is rendered on any secular subject. The majority of us are to some extent guilty of this negligence.
Guilty? I'm guilty. We all guilty of this. Because, listen, if y'all think I came here to fuss, I did, but I'm fussing at myself. Because I'm about 20 pounds heavier than I was when I was here before. And I lost 103 pounds, gained 67 back, and lost 30 from there. Because why? I didn't follow the instructions, and that was my death and my embarrassment and all those things that Dr. Kinley said in there. Go on and finish it out, Kinaway. That was it. Now, the point I'm trying to make is all the information that was brought to you all in 2017 was enough to save you physically, spiritually, psychologically, and emotionally. If you did not take heed and go through that information, then that is on you. Now, Reggie had congestive heart failure. We had a doctor come here, Dr. Sherilyn Lee, who is a holistic doctor. She was a doctor that had been treating Michael Jackson before he passed away, before the other doctor killed him. To have even had that woman come way out here, this woman treats celebrities. This man was the greatest entertainer that ever lived, and she was his doctor. And the reason why she could not save him is because he told her, I want that stuff. I need to sleep. And she said, Michael, what if you don't wake up? That's what she told him. She was so afraid he wouldn't wake up, and her fear came true. She got him to sleep five. No one could have gotten him to sleep 5 hours without anything. She put him on a program that got him to sleep 5 hours straight with no drugs. That was a miracle. I said, this woman has some kind of angelic stuff going on. Who is she if she was able to do that? And if he had stayed on her program, he might still be around. We don't know. I mean, it was his time to go. But he was under pressure, and he said, look, this was great. But I need more sleep, and I need that stuff. And she said, I'm not going to get it for you because what if you don't wake up? And so he said, okay. And He called her 5 days before he died, and he said, half my body's hot, half my body's cold. What does the scripture say about being lukewarm? He was lukewarm. And so she said, Michael, go to the ER. Oh, no, they'll kill me. Michael Jackson wasn't going to the ER. He was afraid they would kill him. He was paranoid. And I told her, look, you can't talk to Michael Jackson like that. You got to say, if you don't get your butt up and go to the ER, so-and-so, so-and-so, you going to die. And then that maybe he would have went. But the point I'm trying to make, and I'm not beating up on Michael because y'all know I love Michael, okay? But your habits and your habits are your habits and your habits, your behavior is your behavior. We all have behavior issues. The point is, she came here and she gave out life-saving information. Reggie called her because she had information on how to start reversing the congestive heart failure. He called. He never went to see her. And now he's gone. And if you would stand Joe Williams next to Chris, they look like brothers. You wouldn't even know that was his. They look like brothers. So when I was told stroke and heart attack, how did that happen? I don't understand. We got all of this. We have to investigate this stuff. Do you understand where we're at now? With the time that we're living in, Yahweh has put a virus that has went through the entire earth and has scared the entire world, and it's invisible. You cannot see it. It is a negative spirit that came to what? Take the breath of life out of you, which means you can't breathe Yahweh no more. That's what it's doing. And what people are failing to realize is one of the things that is killing people. Give me the power within you. And I want you to start where it says Dr. Harris talks about the circulatory system. One of the things that's killing people is the fact that it affects your respiratory. But if you can't get any breath in here, things will start to close up, which will create what? A blood clot. The blood clots is what's been killing people, and that's something they're not telling you. In addition to that, they're putting people on respirators. Your lungs cannot handle the pressure of a respirator. You can survive the coronavirus if you're given the tools and the education to survive it. And that is not what these people are doing in these medical facilities. Do you have it?
I have it, but I haven't found the section about the
Okay. He starts, Dr. Harris mentions the circulatory system. It's about 4 or 5 paragraphs down. Now, we learn in this school that everything goes according, let me know when you get it, Eunice, everything goes according to this pattern, okay? Your body, all 9 systems of the functions of your body, it all goes according to this tabernacle pattern. If you go, somebody get me Exodus 26 chapter, start at the 19th verse. If you go and you do a detailed investigation and you find out how this tabernacle was built, one of the things it was built on the foundation of silver. Do we have it?
I have the circulatory system. Dr. Harris spoke of the blood circulatory system.
Okay.
It is continuously operating and functioning. Moses said that the life of the flesh is in the blood.
The life of the flesh is in the blood. Go on.
Which is comparatively speaking that physical life is the blood. Divine life or spiritual life that is connected with your psychic forces. So put the two together to balance the great overslope or the life.
So he said, put the two together. That's why we have Romans 1:19 and 20, because he said, put the two together to create the balance. See? Now, who has Exodus 26:19?
Okay. I'll get it.
Okay. Because I want to talk about, now, you know, Joshua was assassinated for 30 pieces of silver. Silver is a representation of salvation. When this tabernacle was built, it was built on the foundation of silver. You have Exodus 26, not go ahead.
Exodus 26, 19.
One of the things that Sister Kennaway said when she got up here, she said, people have not been proving things in these schools. Whatever I say to you, I have to prove it. I'm proving it in the scripture. I'm going to the scripture where it talks about silver. Go ahead.
And thou shalt make 40 sockets of silver under the 20 boards.
Okay, so under the 20 boards was 40 sockets of silver. That's building a foundation. Okay? One of the things that they're not telling you when it comes to the coronavirus, you could pass this around, is to take silver. Silver kills viruses and bacteria.
I got some.
They're not sharing this with people. This is called OxySilver 528. And I also have colloidal silver. Now, if silver was used as a foundation to hold up this tabernacle, what do you think it's going to do for your body? That's how you got to look at that. Because I'm taking it back to how this thing was built. Now, when Moses came along and the children of Israel had to get up out of here, you guys need to start studying, and a lot of stuff is in the packet I handed out. Start studying some of these ingredients and different herbs and things that they used in the scripture. Mm-hmm. Because it's life-saving to you. Give me Exodus 12 and 22. Because when they had to come up out of here, they had to kill a lamb. They had to pierce that lamb in the side, and the blood had to come, and they had to take the blood and put it on the inside of the door. Now that really, if you think about that, that sounds like some satanic horror stuff in a thriller movie or something. Put blood on the door? Are you crazy? What kind of crap is that? But that's what it took to get them out of there. Read Exodus 12 and 22.
Exodus 12, 22.
Mm-hmm.
And ye shall take a bunch of hyssop.
No, he said you should take a bunch of hyssop.
Mm-hmm.
Now, did the thought ever occur to anybody in these schools to go look up the benefits of hyssop? Read the benefits of hyssop, Eunice.
You got it.
And you can Google this. The information is out there. Okay, well, you got it. Okay, go ahead.
Hyssop is used to benefit digestive and intestinal problems, liver,
gallbladder.
Gallbladder, colic, respiratory problems.
And he said take a bunch of hyssop and dip it in the hyssop first. Why? Because you're dealing with blood from an animal. So what does that mean? We got to avoid infection. Go ahead and keep reading.
Colic, respiratory problems.
Respiratory problems.
Coughs, common cold, sore throat.
Why?
Asthma.
Because we're putting blood on the door. You're going to breathe that stuff in. He didn't say, just dip it a little bit in the hyssop. What did the scripture say? Read it again. 12:22.
And ye shall take a bunch of hyssop.
He said take a bunch of hyssop. You mean a lot of it. Not just a little, a lot of it. Dip it and then do the instructions. Why? Because you've got to breathe this stuff in. Did it ever occur to you why the high priest never got sick? These high priests didn't get sick. They was dealing with bloody animals.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Why is that? Why didn't they get sick? What was the brazen labor made out of? What is brass? It's copper.
Yeah.
Copper is antiviral and antibacterial. That's why some of the hospitals across the country that have copper stethoscopes, copper bed railings, copper countertops, they have a lower number of people getting sick because copper kills viruses. So it would behoove the government to just give everybody a copper penny, right, and this is your hand sanitizer. Mm-hmm. Now, you can't just get any penny. It has to be 1982 and back, because that's 99% copper. Or you can just order a copper coin, rub your hand on it, and this is your hand sanitizer. So when I found that out, I ordered a bunch of pennies and was running out, handing, giving everybody pennies, the homeless, everybody was just giving out, here's his hand sanitizer. Yeah. And you know, I got some homeless people, well, ma'am, can you give me some more pennies? Because so, they ain't thinking about, you know, I'm trying to save your life. They just wanted the money. And I said, well, you know, if you cash it in, you get 3 cents. An old penny is worth 3 cents. Most people don't know that. So now we got protection on the bottom, because see, Yahweh works all the way around. So this brazen laver where he washed the animals was made out of copper, which is antibacterial, antiviral. At the same time, didn't we say that the incense in the tabernacle was a sweet smelling savior unto Yahweh? Well, who is Yahweh? Yahweh's the high priest. He's got to breathe this stuff in. So, the incense was made of four main ingredients: stacte, onycha, galbanon, and frankincense. Read the benefits. I got it on the paper. Let's start with stacte. Let's see what the benefits are of stacte. You can get this stuff in essential oils.
Stacte used to heal arthritis.
Heal arthritis.
Hardening of clogged arteries.
Hardening of clogged arteries.
Acne and weight loss.
Go on.
Galbanon used to treat rheumatoid arthritis, boost blood circulation, muscle spasms.
Now if they just start giving people a little bit of that, it'll increase the blood flow. When you're dealing with a virus that can cause a blood clot, you got to make sure that flow is constantly moving. I'm a blood clot survivor, so I know what to do to prevent blood clots. Go on.
Muscle spasms, nerves, and respiratory tract.
Mm-hmm.
Oincha is antiseptic, anti-inflammatory, directive. A sedative,
yes.
Frankincense,
if you Google the benefits of frankincense, you know what it says?
Anti-inflammatory.
It benefits the entire nine systems of the body. Why? Wasn't frankincense given to Yahshua at his birth? Frankincense is Yahshua in a bottle. And to just tell you a story, I don't know if you could look this up, but you can actually call the company Young Living, which makes the best essential oils. The owner had a severe spine problem, and he was told by expert doctors that he is going to lose his ability to walk. He flew to South America and got a doctor to inject frankincense in his spine, and he was able to continue to walk. They don't do that in America because they don't care. This is not a place about curing you. This is a place about maintaining you. See? That's what this is about. I have 5 minutes?
5 minutes.
Okay. So, I wanted to make sure that when I came here, we had another conference June 6th online. Because of the corona, we had to do it online. And I brought the packet. It has all of the information in there. I also have some handouts on what reverses and prevents the coronavirus. Lugol's iodine is one of them that was used to kill the Spanish flu.
colloidal silver. Building your immune system is very important. I take enough stuff that if she come over here, she's going to be up for a fight. Do you understand what we're living in right now? We are bombarded with fear. If somebody coughs, people will run away from you like you turned on a light in a room full of roaches. It is just terrible. And I mean, I was in a store the other day. Lady coughed. She had on a mask. Just fear. Start spraying colonial silver. Because we're bombarded with everyone else's fear. See? And you guys are so blessed to be in California because you have Dr. Sherilyn Lee here. And you have Dr. Schultz, who has Herb Farm down in Marina Del Rey. This man got herbs that can reverse and cure everything. I had to come all the way to give you my quick testimony before I get off the floor. I came all the way from Chicago to heal my body. This woman put me on a machine called CRT 2000, which is a thermography machine. It tells you everything that's wrong. Come to find out, my lymphatic system is blocked due to my sinus condition. I've been to 7 sinus doctors, and not one of them told me, Ms. Dantzler, dry brush your skin. Keep your lymphatic system moving because your sinus disease can affect your lymphatic system. Never told me. I just had an ultrasound of my breast. Everything was clear. She found a precancer cell in my breast. Precancer cell is not cancer. It's cancer that's pregnant. But I'm going to abort her. She ain't coming over here.
Yeah.
And she could, you know, I believe in abortion when it comes to a cancer cell.
Yeah. No, that's right.
And then they tell you the standard is a mammogram. A mammogram has radiation. It causes cancer. Do you know how much radiation is in a mammogram? Enough for you to walk in your normal everyday life for 7 weeks. And she only charges $85 for that machine. You all are blessed. I want to save your life. I want to save mine. The next time I come back here, if somebody died, they better have gotten hit by a truck. Because you have everything in that pamphlet to save your life. All you got to do is go and research the stuff that's in the scripture, what we have learned in this school. Before I get out, read the benefits of myrrh, because myrrh was one of them that was also given to Yahshua. And then I'm going to have my seat.
You want me to read that?
Yes.
Myrrh, science-based health benefits, swelling and pain, kills parasite, kills bacteria, oral health, heals sores.
All of that is in the scripture. All you got to do is research it. Okay? These people didn't get sick. I'm not saying they never got sick, but Yahweh put what he gave them because they may not have even known what the benefits was, but he told them. You learn this later. We're learning in ages to come. They never saw what was in here. We have the opportunity to see what was in here, but they never saw it. But they can see it now because even when you get off the flesh, you're still learning. You're still growing. You're still moving. Because Yahshua was always on the move. So I appreciate being here. I have to say this because I posted on Facebook that I was donating. I pick a school every month that I donate to for the sale of the Yahshua mask. And it's interesting that the way Yahweh set this up, he specifically told me last week to get a money order for $34 and give it to your class, and you just looked up the temperature machine and it was $34. Mm-hmm. So I have a $34 money order that I'm donating to this class from the sale of the mask. It's here, here it is. I want everybody to see it and say, prove all things, hold fast, which is good, and I'm giving the money to the class. This is a postal money order. The government is good for some things. You can cash it anywhere. So I thank you for your time and attention. I love you guys. If you need any more information, I'm here. You can call me. You can reach out to me. You can go to Yahshua's Chosen, which is my page on Facebook. Also, we have a cruise Next year, May 16th, the name of the boat is called Glory, and that's also posted. And I'll put the links in the IDMR Ontario of all of the information that was given out here today. I love you guys. Thank you so much for having me, and I yield the floor. Hallelujah.
Thank you. Our last speaker will be Dr. Will Williams.
Okay, good. All right. Good afternoon. It's good to be here. Good to see y'all here to learn more of this great and awesome, stupendous, colossal panoramic vision and revelation given to us by Yahweh Elohim. And I appreciate the previous speakers. The first speaker, I was listening and it, was it brought back to my memories. I could give you my side of the story. Yeah, because when I first met her, she thought I was a patient.
You know, that wasn't too far wrong.
she thought I was a patient. I just hired in there. I was going through orientation. I was working days, and she was on days. And so she was doing something, because she's an occupational therapist, right? So she was doing something with the patients, coloring or something. And I was sitting on the couch, because my job is to monitor, right? You know, so I'm sitting back so I could see the whole room. And she's like, don't you want to come and color with us? And I'm like, no, I really don't want to come over there and color with y'all. You know. But I don't know how we got to talking anyway. So, but we did. You know, it was my knowledge of Japanese history that impressed her. She didn't think I knew anything about Japanese history. And I gave her a tape. She was right about that. It was a TV show, a ninja TV show. It's called Kage no Gunden. Yeah, Kage no Gunden, Shadow Warriors, for the translation is Sonny Chiba. If you ever remember him, he was a martial artist. It was a TV show. It was Kage no Gunden 4. This was like the fourth edition of it. And it's like this, and it's really pretty good. It's, you know, you saw it, right? So it was good. So I gave it to her, and she was like, oh, wow, this guy really knows something about Japan, you know. So, and then we went on a date. I remember it better than she does. At least I know the date. It's August the 10th. That's our anniversary, really, yeah, because that was our first date, you know, on the beach. She likes to go to the beach, and I think I even got some pictures I took.
I have to
go look for them and stuff. And like she said, she was trying to impress me about her knowledge of the Bible, about the wedding feast at Cana. I'm like, okay, what's all this about? But I told her I went to this class, you know, and it was on Sunday. And the first thing she said, what school have classes on Sunday? But then I explained to her, and she came, and she stayed, and we stayed. So we've been together for quite a while, you know, 24 years almost, to be honest with you. So I thought that was kind of interesting, you know.
That's great.
You know, I mean, this is how Yahweh brings people in, you know, so you never know. Okay, yes.
I just wanted to add something that you quit class once, and people said, are you going to quit class too? And I said, no, I'm not coming, because a lot of women come with boyfriends, and then when they break up, they never come back.
Yeah.
But I wasn't coming for him, and I was coming for Yahshua.
Yeah, yeah,
That's it.
She is correct. Because I thought that at first, you know, I'm like, okay, you just, you know. But then I began to realize that she really was serious about learning what's up here on these charts, you know. So, I mean, we got videotaping back in those days, you know. She's asking questions and stuff. And it's a school. You're supposed to. You're supposed to inquire. We want you to do that. But also, we want you to pay attention. Dr. Kendall used to say that a lot. You know, pay attention. Because he didn't mind questions, but he would tell people that if you would just be patient, you know, and let the spirit unfold itself, your questions will be answered, you know, in the course of the discourse, mm-hmm. you know, in a lot of cases. You know, if you just take the time, you just let it, just let the spirit flow, okay? And Valencia, I've done work with her. I've done some work. She's done projects, and I've helped her out. You know, like we produced, like you did the Michael Jackson thing once. And I helped you with that, and I do a little editing for her. She's really a very good producer. You know, to be honest with you, she has good, great talent. And this disease thing, and what she was saying about the oils, she's not the only one, because there's other people in classes that do oils. I know, because when we did the last thing, we had Janice and Terry Welsh, and Janice Welsh right. is very knowledgeable. Yeah, she's very knowledgeable, and I know the other lady, Alice Player, she's very, so it's not some fly-by-night thing what she's talking about with the oils. They are in the scriptures, yeah. And if you do research on them, you will find out that there are medicinal properties, because, see, the scripture says this, Genesis, I think it's the first chapter, and it might be the third day. It talks about for the healing of the nations. Where is that at?
That's Revelation.
Oh, is it Revelation 12? Yeah, okay, that's what I'm thinking. 22 and 2, thank you. Yeah, that's right. That's right. Now start with 1, Revelation 22, 1.
Revelation 22, 1. And he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of Yahweh and of the Lamb. In the midst of the street of it, and on either side of the river, was there the tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruits, and yielded her fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations.
For the healing of the nations. See, because 80% of the drugs we use really come from plants. Mm-hmm. You know, and the... Before the discovery of antibiotics, this was the best thing people could do, was using, you know, the holistic method, you know, oils, you know, using plants, this, that, and the other. And a lot of people got away from it, but here in California, they still pay for the holistic medicine. Like here, they'll pay for acupuncture. And I don't know if they do that in a lot of other states, but in this state, the insurance company will pay for acupuncture. Some people say, well, how do you know if it works? Well, if the insurance company ain't paying for it, that means it ain't working. That's how I look at it. But it does work. You know, I've done acupuncture for, 17 years, and it's just like what the previous speaker said. You know, you have to boost your immune system to a certain extent, you know, eating right and doing certain things to help that, you know. There's another scripture I wanted, I thought. Ezekiel. Yes, that's exactly right. Ezekiel 47 and 12. Mm-hmm.
Ezekiel 47:12.
Uh-huh.
And by the river upon the bank thereof, on this side and on that side, shall grow all trees for meat, whose leaf shall not fade, neither shall the fruit thereof be consumed. It shall bring forth new fruit according to his months, because their waters they issued out of the sanctuary, and the fruit thereof shall be for meat, and the leaf thereof for medicine.
Okay. So now it's in the scripture, so it tells you that, okay? Now, we read something Thursday out of this book here. This is God the Archetype, not Elohim, but the first edition, God the Archetype, which is in public domain. And there are certain things that are in this book that are not in the second edition, particularly in the, well, mostly in the medical section, okay? And so I want, we had something read, but I want something else read as well. You know, I don't think we'll be able to get through it all, but we want to try to. All right, and this is called The Meaning of Disease. Who wants to read? Who feels like reading? You read last time. You want to feel like reading? You,
Miss Sunshine.
Okay, it's God the Archetype. Yes, and it's on page right there. 254, volume 4, God the Archetype. Not Elohim, but God the Archetype. All right, and this is called The Meaning of Diseases, okay? And so it was brought out, you know, how this virus is a type of Satan, but here we're going to get persnickety about it. And we're going to read it from the first edition of our textbook, the physical example and the spiritual type and what it means, if you will.
The meaning of diseases. There are two mysteries which are often spoken of in the Bible, the mystery of iniquity and the mystery of God. It has been the author's intentions throughout this book to clearly show how ignorant we have been concerning God, and it is equally evident that we are ignorant about Satan. It has been stated many, many times in this book that one understands the invisible things by looking at the visible things. Satan is a spirit, and as such, he is invisible. However, God in his justice has made it possible for one to understand the working of Satan by our observation of the disease process or conditions which affects our physical bodies. Accepting the fact that our physical bodies is their normal functioning reflect God in his manifold ways. Then one must accept the fact that our bodies in disease states or abnormal functioning reflects Satan. In addition, it is also noteworthy that as there are many diseased conditions acting in diverse ways, there are many manifestations of the devil which deceives and beguiles us day by day. Let it be said here that the author is not intending to say that one necessarily becomes sick or diseased because he is devilish or has sinned, but is saying that all diseases manifest or reflect how Satan works or accomplishes his end, which is death. Do you recall when Yahshua healed the blind man who had been blind from birth that he was asked, "Master, who did sin? This man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Yahshua answered, "Neither has this man sinned nor his parents, but that the works of Yahweh should be made manifest in him." Thus, it was Yahweh's purpose to manifest in a visible way the working of the devil so that man could have no excuse.
In other words, Yahweh made a physical example so that we could see, so we can understand the operation of the mystery of iniquity. We say it all the time, Romans 1:19 and 20.
Right.
It takes the natural to understand the spiritual.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? We understand the invisible things by understanding that which is visible, that which we can see. And look, and we got this man up here. This is Nebuchadnezzar's dream. This is representative of the world. So really, this virus has infected the world, and the whole world is sick. See, that's just a very simple analogy. You know, now we can get persnickety as you want. See, but we're just looking at types and shadows to understand a spiritual principle. Please continue reading.
Nevertheless, the author would have you believe that diseases or sicknesses, on the other hand, can be a direct result of devilish or satanic influences in an individual. Let us witness the sentence that Yahweh pronounced on Adam after he had sinned. Yahweh said to Adam, "Cursed is the ground for thy sake, and sorrow shall thou eat of it all the days of thy life. Thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to thee." Now, these diseases are thorns and thistles as far as man is concerned. They prick him on every side.
Okay, now, hold it for a minute. Let's just, we'll come back to that. Because we had read about, because people used to believe that. You know, you got sick or you got cursed. Something happened to you. You know, well, your parents must have did something wrong or something, yeah. You know, for the gods to, you know, do this to you, see. Right. Now, Adam here, when he died up here in the garden and he transgressed, that death did pass on all mankind. Mm. See, there's a great scripture. Jeremiah 31:29. We're coming back to the textbook, so don't lose your place there.
Okay.
Just to emphasize this point.
Jeremiah 31:29.
Mm-hmm.
In those days they shall say no more, the fathers have eaten the sour grape.
Now the fathers have eaten the sour grape. What father? Adam, who was the father of all mankind, he ate the sour grape, what, the olive. And let me tell you something, you do not eat an olive directly off the tree. try it. I dare you. You find an olive tree, just pluck it and eat it, and then come back to talk to me. Because you're not going to, because that's a sour grape. And what?
And the children's teeth are set on edge.
And the you eat the grape, but the children's teeth are set on edge. The whole human race was set on edge because of Adam's transgression. Okay, but read.
But everyone shall die for his own iniquity.
But there will come a time where everyone will die for their own iniquity. See, that happens after the death, burial, resurrection of Yahshua Messiah, because now he's the one that took away the stain from Adam's death, and your children are born clean in this age. Now, that doesn't mean that you don't be... You will assimilate this stuff. We told you about this. You will assimilate this in the world from day one. From soon as you're born, you are indoctrinated. I was born on a Thursday in the house. All right? And when the doctor came over, it was actually my 14-year-old aunt. She midwifed me, but she couldn't sign the birth certificate, so they had to pay some guy to come over and do that. But he came over and he signed the birth certificate. Okay, everything checks out all right, and this child was born 6 o'clock a.m., on Thursday, you know, whatever the date is, I ain't telling you my birthday. And so from right then and there, they already then indoctrinated me. They said you were born on a Thursday. Well, Thursday translated as Thor's day. See, so already I haven't even gotten in the world a good 60 seconds. And they said, okay, the baby's fine. And he was born on a Thursday, such a day. You're already indoctrinated me, you know, Thursday. You was born on a Thursday. See, and it goes on from that point on, theories, concepts, opinions, so forth and so on. Okay, but now in this age, because of Joshua's death, burial, resurrection, see, your children see are lifted from this stain and they come in clean. That's how Dr. Kinley put it. See, they're not, you know, because David writes in the Psalms that I was shaped in iniquities. The reason why he said that, because that's what happened back here. But now after this, you're not shaped in iniquity no more, at least not born when you're born into the world. Now, you can become that. You can assimilate this like the Borg and become, you know, some unrighteous dude. You know, but you didn't come in that way because Yahshua was the one who lifted this transgression off of you. Okay, and so now everybody, you know, you're going to have to, you know, now it don't matter what your parents did or didn't do, you're going to have to stand on your own. As Dr. Kinley used to say, every tub will have to sit on its own bottom. Mm-hmm. Okay, did we finish that scripture?
Every man that eateth the sour grape, his teeth shall be set on
now,
edge.
Now when you sin in this age, it'll be your teeth set on edge, not your children or anybody else's. You will be taking that responsibility, see? Anything?
That's it.
Okay, go back to the textbook.
Man has become illuminated with considerable information regarding disease processes, but there is yet a great deal that he has not been exposed to. He is aware of at least the following. One, there is no tissue or organ in the body that is invulnerable to disease. Two, disease can be death-dealing. Three, Disease is ever present and will remain as long as man remains in his physical state.
Just stop for a minute. Take that and just translate it to the spirit. See, it said, as long as man's in the flesh, there'll always be disease. Well, that's like saying, as long as there's flesh, there'll always be a satanic spirit. Yeah. There'll always be a mystery of iniquity as long as there is flesh. But that will end one day. And when that ends, so will his mystery end. Okay, continue.
Four, diseases are transmittable from one person to another in many instances.
You see, because of invisible little things called microbes or germs, and can be passed by various, look, we got sight, touch, sound, taste, and smell. Most diseases can be passed along on some of these little, you know, either by touch or by taste. Some cases you can smell something and it'll, you know, it'll hurt you.
Yeah.
Rarely, but it's not impossible. You can look at something and it can be affected by something, you know, or something get into your eyes. Hmm. Put it like that. See, your senses that sense everything are also the vulnerable opening points for any disease. See, go ahead.
Five. Disease is already present in the body before physical signs or symptoms are recognizable.
Mm-hmm.
Six, the longer a disease remains in a body, the harder it is to eradicate and lesser the chance of eradication.
Now, that reminds me of a scripture. I think it's, keep your finger there. Matthew 12, I'm thinking 48.
Matthew 12 and 43. When the unclean spirit is gone out of a man, he walketh through dry places seeking rest and finding none. Then he saith, I will return into my house from whence I came out. And when he is come, he findeth it empty, swept, and garnished. Then goeth he and taketh with himself seven other spirits more wicked than himself, and they enter in and dwell there, and the last state of that man is worse than the first. Even so shall it be also unto this wicked generation.
Now see, now that's what happens. See, it's once the house is clean, swept, and garnished, but if it's empty, see, and there's nobody to defend it, then the one that got kicked out, he's going to get seven others, which is eight altogether, and going to come back and bum rush.
Yeah.
And then now once they get up in there, then they're going to be in trouble. They say, no, we ain't going nowhere.
Take over.
We're staying right here.
Take over.
And see, so now the state of that man will be worse than what it was in the beginning. And that's the same way with some diseases. Because there are people that get cancer and stuff, and they get it cut out. But then if they don't get it all, and when it comes back, it comes back with a vengeance.
Yep.
You know? And you'd be like, and then what are you going to do then? Mm-hmm. It's just hard to overtake it. See, okay, go back to the textbook.
Seven, a diseased organ or tissue in a body may cause similar diseases of other organs or tissues.
Mm-hmm.
Eight, a diseased organ or tissue, once apparently healed, often relapse, and the reoccurrent condition is worse than the former condition.
Just like I just said, that happens with something like cancer.
Mm-hmm.
That happens like that. But mm-hmm. Read.
Nine, some diseases are hereditary and passed along from generation to generation in a family tree.
There's some diseases like that, like hemophilia or sickle cell. I knew people like that, that sickle cell. Other diseases, certain mental illnesses are like that, you know. Mm-hmm. You skip over, you know. So certain diseases you just can't avoid, you know, because of, well, like I said, they're hereditary. You can deal with it, but you can't, you know, unless, you know, you get into the DNA itself and get rid of that cell, you know, I mean, which they're almost at that point now, you know, learning how to do because they can clone stuff now, I mean, at the DNA level and stuff, you know. But basically, it's just showing you that diseases are a type of the mystery of iniquity, and as long as there's flesh, you will have the mystery of iniquity. Just that plain and simple. Okay, continue.
Let us briefly examine each of these facts about disease and comparing it with the satanic spirit. In reference to number one.
Yeah, in reference to number one, which the list that she read, the number one was...
There is no tissue or organ in the body that is invulnerable to disease.
That's all right, now this is what he's going to make the comparison. Read.
When Adam transgressed, all of the human race was concluded under sin.
Mm-hmm.
Insomuch as Adam represents the whole human race, and we are all descendants from him.
Mm-hmm.
It is plain to see that each organ or tissue, being members of our own body, bear the same relationship to it as we do to Adam. In other words, each organ is a member of the body, and each person is a member of the whole human race,
mm-hmm.
which came out of Adam's body.
We're all one flesh. I heard Dr. Kinley say that in the lecture. The whole human race is one flesh because we came from one man. The thing we're trying to do is to become one in the spirit,
mm-hmm.
in Yahweh. But we're already one in the flesh. All 8 right. billion people on this planet is one flesh. I like to say it like this. We're all first cousins to each other. Just 8 mm-hmm. billion times removed. See? Okay? Go ahead.
Accordingly, as each one of us is born in sin, there is likewise no organ or tissue which is exempt from disease.
Now, see, now it says that we are born in sin. But see, that... We were under Adam's transgression, but with Yahshua, see, when he comes along, see, that negates that. That erases the Adamic transgression. So we're not born in sin anymore, not under the Adamic transgression. That does not happen in this age. See, all right, go ahead.
Number two.
Now, number two, what was number two?
Disease can be death-dealing.
All right, now, disease can be death-dealing. I think that's a no-brainer right there. Read.
Number two, hardly needs an explanation for anyone knows that the wages of sin is death.
The wages of sin is death. Go ahead.
Just as the end result of many diseases is death.
Mm-hmm.
Concerning number three, disease is ever present and will remain as long as man remains in his physical state.
Mm-hmm.
Concerning number three, man's earliest writings carry accounts of sicknesses or diseases, and the present scene does not indicate any let up in sickness or the overall incident of diseases.
Now, this was written in 1961. This was like over, what, almost 60 years ago. And the conditions haven't changed. That's what mm-hmm. he just said. You know, they're introducing, and look, there were more diseases being introduced in the last 60 years that we didn't even know about. I didn't know anything about Ebola or the swine flu or West Nile disease or Zika, you know. I mean, I didn't hear any of that stuff when I was growing up. I heard about measles and chicken pox and, you know, that kind of stuff. You know, because we had to get vaccinated for those things. But then as time went on, more diseases and stuff has come out. The multiplicity of that. Why? Just showing you the endless multiplicity of the satanic spirit or the mystery of iniquity and his boys, the multiplicity. Because remember, 1/3 of the angelic host was cast out and down here. The angelic host is innumerable. So 1/3 of innumerable is innumerable.
Take a guess.
Okay? Continue reading.
Mm-hmm. Likewise, those old satanic spirits which were cast out of heaven before mm-hmm. their earthly creation are reserved until the day of judgment
mm-hmm.
to be punished. Four, diseases are transmittable from one person to another mm-hmm. in many instances.
See, they're transmittable, as we showed you, because you got senses, you know. You know, you talk, you touch, you know, you breathe, all of that. It's got just many ways. Go ahead.
As to number four, concerning the transmission of diseases from one to another, do you recall Yahshua saying to Peter, "Get thee behind me, Satan,"
mm-hmm.
when Peter rebuked him about saying that he, Yahshua, would have to go to Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and to be killed and to be raised the third day?
Mm-hmm.
Well, Peter was possessed of a satanic spirit at that time.
So when Yahshua was talking, he said, this has got to happen to me. Peter, which Satan, of whom Satan was in, he said, oh, this ain't going to happen to you. And then Yahshua just turned around and said, get thee behind me, Satan. You know, you're an offense, so in so many words. And so he left Peter and read, because this is what happened.
However, this same satanic spirit later left Peter and was entered into Judas.
In other words, he transmitted. In other words, he left from one host and went to another. Just like if I was diseased and I touched you,
the virus.
And if it was really contagious, then whatever I got is transferred to you.
Yeah.
And then you got it. That's what it's showing you here about the satanic spirit left Peter and transmitted itself to Judas. Read.
This same satanic spirit later left Peter and entered into Judas, which clearly points up to the similarity in the transmission of disease and the transmission of the satanic spirit.
See, because by preaching, because see, look, here's the coronavirus. This is what people say. It's caused by breathing. You can sneeze or, you know, whatever, and it goes out. Well, consider this. People go to church or go to their religious sessions, whatever it might be. You know, you listen to your guru, your imam, your priest, your preacher, and he's talking. Mm-hmm. And he's talking all this erroneous doctrine stuff. And so you're picking it up because you're listening to it. You're hearing it. And so you're being infected by that. Because you're saying, oh, yeah, yes, all right, yeah, Allah is right, you know, Buddha is this, or that. You're listening to, he's transmitting.
The virus.
His virus, his doctor, he's transmitting it. And you're sitting there, and you're absorbing it, and as you're absorbing it, you know, because whatever he might be, you're absorbing it, and you're turning into whatever he is, or she is.
And can't
That's
breathe.
The spiritual application to that.
Right.
See, read.
5. Disease is already present in the body before physical signs or symptoms are recognizable. In reference to number 5, the author has already shown the time that the devil or Satan entered Judas, but it was not until the night of the Passover Supper that he actually showed signs of the devil being in him.
Mm-hmm.
That is, when he actually kissed Yahshua on the cheek and subsequently betrayed him into the hands of his enemies. One can really see the similarity of this situation to that of the diseases having an incubation period before symptoms are evident.
In other words, Judas didn't look like he was going to betray him for those 3.5 years he's with him. He was the bag man, for that matter, you know, the one that he was the treasurer. He took care of the money.
Mm-hmm.
And even when Yahshua at the Last Supper, where we at here? Here at the Last Supper, he even said outright, one of you is going to betray me.
Right.
And they were like, which is me? And they still couldn't see it. They still couldn't figure it. And even Yahshua went as far as saying, whoever dips the sop with me is to be the one. And they saw it, and they still didn't see it.
Yeah.
See? They still didn't see the symptoms. I mean, Judas was there to betray, but they didn't see the symptoms. He was just doing, they was just like, you know, and then Yahshua told him, and said, well, whatever you got to do, go do quickly. Mm-hmm. The other guys thought, oh, well, he's probably going to do something, you know, for the poor or something, you know. some job. They didn't think nothing about it. It's, oh, well, he's got the money. Maybe he's going out to go get some more supplies or something. Uh-huh. They didn't think nothing about it. And they went to the garden, and they out here praying, and here comes Judas with a whole bunch of men, some soldiers. You know, armed up. I mean, to the point even Peter's like, oh, wait a minute. Oh, we in a rumble? Oh, shoot. You know, he pulled out his sword, cut the priest and servant's ear off. And Yahshua said, no, man, put your sword up.
Yep.
That's not what we're doing here. Healed the man up and allowed Judas to continue showing off his symptoms of being infected. Because one, he brought the soldiers with him.
Right.
Two, he showed them that he was with them by kissing Yahshua, which was the sign of betrayal because they didn't know who he was.
Mm-hmm.
Which one is Yahshua? You know, and you know, okay, don't worry, I'll point him out. I'll just kiss. The one who I kiss will be him.
That's him.
And that was showing Judas showing his symptoms of his infection. Of the mystery of iniquity, which is like a disease.
Yeah.
Read.
6, the longer a disease remains in a body, the harder it is to eradicate and lesser the chance of eradication. Referring to number 6, there is no doubt in anyone's mind that Pharaoh of Egypt was possessed of the devil, and is also known that the longer the devil stayed in Pharaoh, the harder his heart became.
In other words, he just became entrenched. Any other normal person would have said, look, the first the first plague was the Nile River turning to blood. You know, and look, it was brought, the Nile River is the longest river on the planet. It's like at least 4,000 miles long. And there's the Nile, And it splits off into two. There's the Blue Nile and the White Nile. But the Nile itself, and so somebody else pointed it out. I had to think. I said, you know, that's right. Because it's the only river that goes backwards. I mean, most rivers flow from north to south, or east to west, or west to east, rather. But the Nile River flows from south to north and empties into the Mediterranean Sea. But it travels 4,000 miles. In fact, that used to be a big thing for certain explorers to try to find the source of the Nile, which meant that you had to go into the interior, into the heart of the African continent. Mm-hmm. Okay. Huh?
Victoria Lakes.
Yes. You know, I've been there. Victoria, yeah. Right. Yeah, all of that, yeah. It's wonderful. But like I said, I would have just, after seeing the Nile River turn to blood, that would have been it for me. I said, oh.
I know, that's
all right. Yep. Go on, leave. Yep. Yeah. You need anything? Come on, give me some stuff. See y'all, you know. Don't hit the door, knob hit you, you know.
Yeah, I'm good.
But Pharaoh, man, see, and Yahweh hardened his heart. The way Dr. Kinley explained, he said, look, he said Pharaoh was too soft. I had to toughen him up some, you know, so to show my power, see, because he hardened his heart. And look, he hardened his heart each time after each plague, you know, and it was worse and worse. And he just kept hardening his heart. Just like a disease, it just gets entrenched in you, and you get worse and worse.
Right.
Mm-hmm. See? Read.
Even when he finally released the Israelites, he gave chase and met his death by drowning in the Red Sea.
Uh-huh.
So it is with a disease. The longer it stays in a body unabated, the harder it is to uproot and will often lead to death of the individual.
Just like here with Pharaoh. See, it was just embedded in him, and the only outcome for him was death. Okay, continue.
7, a diseased organ or tissue in a body may cause similar diseases of other organs or tissue. Now turning to number 7, which refers to a disease of one organ spreading to another organ, there appears to be a repetition of number 4. However, in this instance, the author is referring to the nature of satanic spirits to spoil or defile those persons who have once been freed from Satan, seeing that all of us were born in sin. Paul speaks of it in this wise. Know ye not that a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump? 1 Corinthians. Here he was admonishing the Corinthians for having fornicators among them.
Mm-hmm.
Likewise, one diseased organ can damage or disease another or others. In another place, Paul is speaking of this ability of satanic spirits to spoil those who have been partakers of the gospel. Ask the Galatians, O foolish Galatians, who has been with you that you should not obey the truth?
Mm-hmm.
Are you so foolish, having begun in the spirit? Are you now made perfect by the flesh?
Okay. So now, in other words, one diseased organ can damage another. In other words, in the body.
Yes.
See, somebody can come up with erroneous doctrine. And that doctrine will spread from one class to another.
Mm-hmm.
See, like, for example, the doctrine of worshiping Kinley. See, it started off one way, and then people, and it started in one organ, and then it started infecting other organs or other classes. See? Until the whole body practically is diseased. As one person told me once, you know, about the state of IDMR, as it is a sick old man and nigh unto death.
Hmm.
And it's been that way for quite a while.
Sure
enough. Continue.
8. A diseased organ or tissue, once apparently healed, often relapses, and the reoccurrence a condition is worse than the former condition.
Mm-hmm.
As we move to number 8, which refers to the ability of a disease condition to recur and thus bring about a worse condition than the initial one. Again, Paul, speaking of this, states that is impossible to renew those again unto repentance who have once tasted of the heavenly gift,
mm-hmm.
and who were once enlightened, if they shall fall away. Yahshua also taught the same thing in speaking by a parable to the Pharisees. He said, when the unclean spirit is gone out of a man, he walketh through dry places, seeking rest and finding none. He said, I will return unto my house whence I came out. And when he cometh, he findeth it swept and garnished.
Mm-hmm.
Then goeth he and taketh to him 7 other spirits, mm-hmm. more wicked than himself.
Mm-hmm.
And they entered in and dwell there. Mm-hmm. And the last state of that man is worse than the first. Yes, there is no doubt that the diseases portray satanic spirits in our bodies.
Okay, now what he's talking about is like, for example, people, and you've known some, people will come to class, and they'll stay for a while. They'll learn something, and be for a while, maybe even years. And then for some reason, they just say, nah, I'm tired of this, I'm leaving. And they disbelieve. I've seen people, just leave and just say, I'm going back to whatever I was.
Wow.
See? See, as the scripture says, the dog, I said, where's that at?
The dog went to return to the
Yes, vomit. In Peter, yes. You know what that says? It's in 2 Peter, ain't it? Second Peter 2:19. Let's read that.
Second
Peter 2:19. While they compromise them liberty, they promise them liberty, they themselves are the servants of corruption. For of whom a man is overcome, of the same is he brought in bondage. For if after they have escaped the pollution of the world through the knowledge of the Redeemer and Savior, Yahshua the Messiah, they are again entangled therein and overcome, the latter end is worse with them than the beginning.
In other words, don't come in here and accept Yahshua for a while and then say, oh, I'll forget it and leave. Because whatever what you came out of, you go back into that, it's going to be worse for you than what it was when you came out. That's what it's telling you. And that's the way like some diseases are. As we just told you, some people may go through cancer and get it out. But if they don't get it all out, see, then it comes back. And it comes back with a vengeance and it just spreads so quickly they can't do anything. That's the same way that can happen to you, spiritually speaking, quickly.
9.
Keep reading the scripture. Scripture.
Okay. For it had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness,
mm-hmm.
than after they have known it to turn from the holy commandment,
mm-hmm.
delivered unto them. But it is happened unto them according to the true proverb.
Mm-hmm.
The dog is turned to his own vomit again. And the sow that was washed to her wallowing in the mire.
So see that's what happens to people spiritually when they hear the truth and accept it, and then they get God's going to get something else. I think it's another one in Hebrews.
Proverbs 26 and 11.
I want Hebrews 6:1 since we're close by. I think it's 6:1.
Hebrews 6:1, Therefore, leaving the beginning of the doctrine of the Messiah, let us go on unto perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from works of death and of faith toward Yahweh, of the doctrine of baptism and of laying on of hands and of resurrection of the dead and of eternal judgment. And this will we do if Yahweh permits. For those who were once enlightened and have tasted of the heavenly gift and were made partakers of the Holy Spirit and have tasted the good word of Yahweh and have powers of the ages to come. If they shall fall away, it is impossible to renew them again unto repentance, seeing they crucified to themselves the Son of Yahweh afresh and put him to an open shame.
Okay, see, now that's what happens, okay? You said you had something?
It's just another reference to the dog returning to his own Proverbs.
Oh, yeah, that's what Peter was quoting from.
He was quoting from Proverbs.
A lot of people don't realize that. A lot of stuff in the so-called New Testament is quoting from the old. Okay? Let's go back to the textbook. We finish this out.
9. Some diseases are hereditary and passed along from generation to generation in a family tree. 9. Okay. In enlarging upon number 9, which states that diseases are hereditary and passed along from generation to generation in a family tree, Yahshua said, in reproving the unbelieving Jews, ye are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar, and the father of it. This is an adequate proof that some of us are destined to play the satanic role, and there is nothing we can do about it. This role has been passed down to us from our fathers, or was inherited. Paul, the apostle, elaborating on this point, said in Romans, has not the potter power over the clay of the same lump to make one vessel unto honor and another unto dishonor? So it is that the satanic role can be inherited or passed down from one generation to another, just as diseases are so done. Now let us go on to specifics. You want to go on
that
part?
Yes.
Since there is the mystery of iniquity, and since iniquity is manifested in our physical bodies by disease, there must be a disease which afflicts mankind, which is still a mystery or unsolved as to the cause and the cure. Accordingly, since there is a principal iniquitous force, Satan himself, who is aided and abetted by his ministers or satanic angels, then it is necessarily a fact that the disease which represents Satan must be the number one killer of all and all other diseases, secondarily to it in killing power. In a consideration of the leading cause of death in all age groups, the nod will have to go to cancer as the number one killer. There is one person in the world today who is the personification of Satan himself. And that person is hidden as far as the understanding of the people is concerned. This particular individual is not a bad individual as far as flesh and blood goes, but his body is the dwelling place of the prince of devils himself, Satan. This is unknown by the teeming millions of people, but the Bible speaks of it thusly. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposeth and exalteth himself all above that is called Yahweh, or that is worship, so that he as Yahweh sitteth in the temple of Yahweh, showing himself that he is Yahweh. And again, there is wisdom. Let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. So one can see that the Bible bears out the fact that there is such a man in the world today who is leading millions of people to a spiritual death.
Now, see, that's the thing. See, people are talking about all this coronavirus. Well, what about the spiritual death that's been happening?
That's
right. It's a lot more than a million folks, I'm telling you, because he's got billions. See, and you got these other folks here, they got billions, and you know, this encompasses the whole human race as far as their belief system and stuff. And so that's the true virus that's infecting mankind for thousands of years. The physical points to the spiritual. And see, and he said, and now at that time in 1961, cancer was the number one thing. It could be anything else. It could be this coronavirus could be the number one killer right now. It would still point to him. Talking about the Pope of Rome, because see, it's something physical to point out something spiritual. Yeah. Next year, it could be something else. I heard bubonic plague was coming back. It could be that. I'm more scared of that than I am of this COVID.
Yeah.
Because you could die in a day for that. You know, COVID, like people say, you can survive. I had two of my brothers had COVID, and they survived it, one in Illinois and the other in Germany. So you can survive, but bubonic plague, I don't know about that. I'd be, you know. Oh, man, that's a lot more deadlier. Like I said, you can get in at sunrise and be dead at sundown in the same day. There's a college course on it I was watching. I mean, they was breaking it down, you know, about the epidemiology of it and the different way it manifests itself and bus stools and, you know, all this kind of stuff. Oh, my gosh, it's crazy. But it doesn't matter what the disease of the year of the day is. It's all pointing to the mystery of iniquity. Mm-hmm. And it's pointing to him who is a manifestation of that. With the mark of the beast, 666. That's what it's really pointing to, that the virus that has afflicted the world today, see, is the spiritual erroneous doctrine that's being preached by all these different doctrines. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir. Speak up a little louder.
Microphone. Notes when me, you, and Eric used to come and teach us at the house, pointing to that, and you brought up the doctrine of discovery, doctrine of Christian discovery, pointing to the spread of that doctrine.
Mm-hmm.
Some old notes. I just had to tell you that.
We had a lot of fun in that garage. But yeah. Well, you know, here, see, that's why England is on here. Because England, when they took over the Spanish did rule for a time. I mean, they you know, conquered the so-called New World, North and South America, and, you know, got gold from the Incas and the Aztecs, and they were doing pretty good until after the English started coming up and the Spanish Armada, which Yahweh, you know, gave to the English via a storm, see, and Francis Drake, who was probably one of the best pirates ever lived, a privateer, you know, just going up and down the Spanish main, robbing and plundering, you know, that kind of thing, which made England, you know, a big player. And so they, in turn, took over from Spain as far as trade routes and stuff, and they went out and like you said, so-called discovery, went out and conquered the world. And they brought the Bible with them. See, and they took the Bible and they preached to all the natives, whoever they came across. It's like one African guy told me, he said, yeah, I remember when the Europeans came. You know, they had the Bible and we had the land. And the next thing you know, we got the Bible and they got the land. So, let me tell you, that happened worldwide. Okay, and that's part of the reason why the majority of people on this planet speak English, because of the British Empire and the King James Bible, which is written in English. See? Okay. Mm. Yes, give her a mic. She wants to say something quickly because we're almost out of time. Who's got a mic? Just quickly say something.
There are, oh.
There are still some cases of the bubonic plague over in Europe right now today. I just wanted to share that because you mentioned that. So it never really went away. They just got it under control.
Okay. We're almost out of time. I'll read the one last paragraph and just finish that up, and we'll be finished with this in the textbook. Wherever you left.
Such a man is hard to recognize or detect, for he does not go around with horns sticking out of his head, or does he carry a pitchfork in his hand?
Mm-hmm.
For Satan is transformed into an angel of light,
mm-hmm.
and so are his ministers. Keep going.
Yes.
So you can see by the above comments that Satan is hidden and disguised in such an exalted personality.
Mm-hmm.
The author need not tell you that cancer follows the same pattern. Its cause and cures are unknown. It afflicts mankind in such a stealthy fashion that one is unaware that he has the disease until it's too late.
Mm-hmm.
It is insinuous in its onset, is not a respecter of person, afflicts the young and the old alike, mm-hmm. and deals death to particularly all its afflicts.
Okay, now, I will finish with that. That's just a long section, but it gives you an idea of what we're talking about. It's just like now that they try to find cures for diseases. Some diseases they find a cure for, others you can't. And, you know, and they would say, well, you just have to do this and the other and learn to live with it. But there is a cure for erroneous doctrine. That cure is Yahshua the Messiah. See? That's the cure. See, the cure that infects mankind, that has always infected mankind from the very beginning all the way down. See, diseases.
Mm-hmm.
See, diseases have always inflicted mankind, okay? This is a type of the satanic spirit. And so they find a cure, they may not find a cure, but we're telling you that there is a cure,
mm-hmm.
see, which is Yahshua, which is going to cure all of this. See, which is going to cure, it's going to cure all of this. Why? Because it's going to knock it out. It's going to destroy it. It's going to eradicate it so that the true man of who you really are will shine through. See, this is the health. See, this is the true immune system that you need to get into. See, the immune system of the Holy Spirit that's going to, now look, that doesn't mean that, you know, you're not going to get sick, because look, death comes to everybody,
mm-hmm.
no matter what, you know, and when it's your time, it's your time, mm-hmm. see. And but Dr. Kinley did say that a lot of times, you know, if we, you know, a lot of things that we could avoid if we took the time and investigate certain things that would give us better quality of life. That you're not going to have cessation of life. And even though everybody's trying it, you know, from every way, from cryogenics to whatever, you know, but, you know, the flesh was never made to be immortal. It barely was made to the last 100 years.
Really?
All right. But it was never made to be immortal, see, and neither was the devil. He's not immortal either. See, he has a beginning and he has an ending, just like the flesh does. Just as flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of Yahweh, neither does the mystery of iniquity. Okay? All we can tell you is simply this. Take the time to learn who you really are. See, come to yourself. As Dr. Kinley used to say, see yourself. What do you mean? See who you really are. That is to say that you, the you that you really are you, is created in the image and likeness of Yahweh. And when you get in touch with that, you can have no better immune system ever. Okay? All right? Thank you for your time and patience. And here she go again. you have to wait.
I just wanted to make one announcement when I talked about all atoms being in three parts and one was two.
An announcement or a statement?
Just a statement adding to my lecture. I was nervous up there. The only one with the two parts is a hydrogen atom, and you could look at page 52 in the textbook to read about it. That's it.
Okay. Now. Thank you for your time and patience. She threw me off my game. Be safe. Be healthy. Be Joshua, who is your only hope of glory. Hallelujah.
Good old Kennaway strikes again. She came in this way, she'll leave that way.
I hope so.
This has been another lecture sponsored by Ontario of IDMR. Besides Kennaway, do we have any other questions? No? Any announcements?
No business meeting this month. Next month.
I'm really happy to be here, and hopefully if we can continue this conversation, they have a Golden Corral on 4th Street, and they're letting everybody eat outside, and they're practicing all the safety measures. So if some of you would like to meet me over there, it's only $10 for a buffet.
Wow. Okay. We hold class here on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 to 9:30. On Sundays from 11 to 1. All donations will be accepted by Eunice Reiser. Please stand to be dismissed. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power. But before all times, now and forever, let us all say, Hallelujah. Hallelujah.